time, Brother Ron.
Amen.
Did anybody tell you ahead of time?
Amen.
Sanctuary that I may dwell among them. And then in verse 22 he says,
He's talking about the ark. He said, you put the mercy seat on the ark, right, with the cherubim, and you put that on the ark, and there I will meet with you. Right. That's a fundamental change in the way God dealt with men. Up until that point, there was no designated way to meet God, no designated place to meet God. And like I said, of course, there were saints during that period of time, but they had no fellowship with God. That had been lost by the sin of Adam and Eve. Now let's go over to Exodus chapter 40, verse 33. So in chapter 25 there was a requirements given and a promise made. He said, if you make this ark, and he gave him all the instructions, this wide, you know, this big, you make it out of this, you make this kind of gold and so forth, and there I will meet with you. That was the promise. The requirements are you make it like this. In chapter 40, verse 33, and he speaking of Moses, reared up the court round about the tabernacle and the altar and set up the hanging of the court gate. So Moses finished the work.
Right.
In other words, he met the requirements.
Right.
God said, you make a tabernacle with a fence around it.
Right.
You make it this big. You make the lampstand. And he gave him all these instructions.
Yes.
And between chapter 25 and 40, it's detailed accounts of how Moses made these things, and he went and got men who were very skilled at whatever trade they needed. Carpenters to do woodwork, and goldsmiths to do the metalwork, and there's detailed accounts in here of how he did all this. And it says he did it like he, like the pattern God showed him in the mountain. So here in verse 33, it says Moses finished the work. So he met the requirements in verse 34. Then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. So God kept his promise. You meet the requirement, this is the benefit you will get. You will get my presence. And here God manifested his presence to them. The same thing happened in the temple. If you look in 2 Chronicles chapter, we'll do chapter 5. And then a couple of verses in chapter 7. Excuse me. Now when the children of Israel carried the tabernacle, you know, the tabernacle was a portable structure, and they carried that with them as they wandered through the wilderness. And then even once they got into the promised land, they had the tabernacle for many years. And one day David said, you know, he's sitting there and he was thinking he was in the palace. He said, you know, I had nice palaces and I had sealed houses and there's no room for the ark of the Lord. I need to make an ark for God's house. But that was his thought. That wasn't God's thought. So he told the prophet, he said, this is what I want to do. And he besought the prophet to pray to God. And so God appeared to David and he said, you can't build me a house because you shed them some blood. You see, even though God didn't tell him specifically to do this, David had this desire to start to honor God and have a place for the Ark of the Covenant. But what David forgot was that we do things God's way, God's calendar. And he wanted to do this, and that's a good thing. But God said, no, you can't do that, but I'll let your son do it. So David received from God the pattern of the temple, how many rooms to make, how many porches to make, how big was to be, and all his elaborate instructions. And then David gave that to his son Solomon, much to the chagrin of the masons, who was just the Solomon's child up and was the first mason and all. But God gave the instructions to David.
Right.
And David gave them to Solomon.
Right.
And Solomon was charged just like Moses. God said, you do it like this.
Right.
And I'll meet you there. So in 2 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 1, thus all the work that Solomon made for the house of the Lord was finished.
Right.
Just like for Moses. And Solomon brought in all the things that David his father had dedicated, and the silver and the gold and all the instruments that he put, and he put among the treasures of the house of God. So then, if you jump down real fast, verse 13, and it came to pass as the trumpeters and the singers were as one to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. And when they lifted up their voices with the trumpets and the cymbals and instruments of music and praised the Lord, saying, for he is good,
amen,
for his mercy endureth forever.
Amen.
Then the house was filled with the cloud in the house of the Lord. Exactly what happened at the tabernacle.
Right.
Moses met the requirements. God manifested his presence.
Right.
Then he did the same thing. Solomon met the requirements. God manifested his presence. Kept his promise. He always does. And then chapter 7, verse 1. Now when Solomon had made an end of praying, the fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house.
Amen.
So, once again, they now have a place where they know they can go to meet God.
Right.
The tabernacle had long since perished because of the sin of David and others. They used it for trinkets and religious things. They even took the ark out and carried it with them on the battlefield to try to defeat the enemy.
Right.
And use it as a luck, good luck charm.
Right.
And God was sorely displeased with that, because the holy things of God that are sanctified and set apart for his service are not good luck charms.
Amen.
That's
right. Amen.
And he got to the point even where the heathen took the ark.
That's right.
And they had lost it. The children of Israel had lost the place where they could fellowship with God. And it had been many years until Solomon met the requirements and God came and filled the temple.
Right.
And so God kept his promise.
Yes.
But there was a problem, of course, like always.
Right.
Isaiah 59, verse 2. Well, I'll read verse 1 and 2. Read 1 also. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save. Is ear heavy that it cannot hear.
Right.
But your iniquities is separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear.
Right.
Now the requirements of God was, if you look in Deuteronomy, the man of God was to learn the law,
right,
memorize the law, teach it to his children, study it diligently,
right,
and observe to do all the things in the law.
Right.
They threw that out. They didn't bother with that, and their iniquity separated between them and God. And now, once again, they had no place to fellowship with God, no place they can go and know that God will meet me there, and I'll be blessed there, and I'll be in the presence of God.
Right.
And so it is today.
Yes.
Things haven't changed. I think somebody said the more things change, the more they stay the same.
Right.
Yeah. But it's true now. Excuse me, the same way, but God's requirements haven't changed.
That's
holy,
right,
as I am holy. That's never changed a bit.
Amen.
Look in Acts chapter 2. I'm trying to get through this and bring it up to today's time. Try to make it relevant to us today. Acts chapter 2, verse 36. Excuse me, through 41. Now this is where Peter is preaching. A great multitude gathered there, and he began to preach to them.
Right.
And the Lord had been recently crucified,
right,
and had risen from the grave, gone back to heaven, was seated at the Father's right hand.
Right.
And when Jesus was here, he told them, when I'm gone, I'll send the Comforter.
Yeah.
And he'll teach you all things whatsoever I've taught you, he will bring to your remembrance.
Yeah,
and
amen.
So these people were here, and Peter stood up and began to preach, and I won't read the whole sermon that he preached, but in verse 36, he said, "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made this same Jesus, whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ." Now, when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Then Peter said unto them, "Repent." There's your requirement.
Yeah, right.
If you want to have fellowship with God, it starts with repentance.
Yes, right.
God will grant you repentance, Acts 13:48. You can't have fellowship with God without repentance.
That's right.
Without leaving your sin. Sometimes
right.
I see people, I work with them in the shipyard, and they see me reading the Bible or
yeah.
something, and it's, oh, I'm a Christian too,
yeah.
and I never know it.
Exactly.
All the, you know,
yes.
mouth, feel, you know, vulgar,
yeah.
just spews out of over their mouth and talking about getting liquored up on me
yes.
again. I'm
right.
like, wait a minute.
Right.
There's no fellowship with God there.
Exactly.
So they said, "What do we do?" Peter said, "Repent."
Right.
"And be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remissions of sin, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost."
Right.
There's the promise.
Yeah.
So the requirements are repent, mm-hmm. and the promise is you'll receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, the gift of the Holy Ghost is not jibber jabber and some
right.
tongue nobody can
right.
understand and all that foolishness.
Right.
The gift
right.
of the Holy Ghost is eternal life.
Amen.
It says in Romans, "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life."
Right.
That's the gift of the Holy Ghost, is
that's
eternal
right.
life.
Amen.
And that still hasn't changed.
Amen.
So what? How does this all tie in for us today? 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. Give me a second. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. Most of us can probably quote this. "There is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus."
Right.
He's the only access to the Father.
Amen.
It's not a smorgasbord or a buffet where you can say, "Well, you know, I sort of like this part about mayo, and I sort of like this part about Buddha, and
right.
You know, Zen's sort of nice." I like it. It's not that.
That's right.
You meet God through His Son, Jesus Christ.
That's, right.
That's the only way
that's right.
that we have access to Him.
Amen.
It's like the still small voice. I say 30. Text 30 verse 21 says, "You'll hear a still small voice saying, 'This is the way, walk ye in it.'"
Well,
the way is singular.
Right.
It's not a way,
right.
or
right.
pick one, or here, you know, here's some options, which one do
right.
you like?
Right.
There's one way.
Amen.
And Jesus is that way.
Amen.
If you look in John 14 verse 6, Paul said to him, "Lord, we know not where thou goest, how can we know the way?"
Right.
And Jesus said unto him, "I am the way,
that's right.
the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me."
Right.
So this is the same thing. If we want to have fellowship with the Father, Jehovah, the eternal creator, the one that holds us in his hand, controls our life, if we want to have fellowship with him, he is declaring we have to do so through his Son.
Right.
Just like he told Moses, "You make it like the pattern I showed you."
Right.
"And there I'll meet with you." He didn't say, "Sort of make it,
that's
you know,
right.
sort of like this,
yeah, right.
you know, if you can." He said, "Make it like this."
Right, right.
"And then I'll meet with thee." He told the same thing to Solomon.
Yep.
"This is the pattern. You do it like this, or I'll meet with thee." And it's the same thing for us. We want to serve God. We do it through His Son, Jesus Christ. So, John chapter 10. Back up a little bit. John chapter 10, verse 7. Then said Jesus, Jesus unto them again, Verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep.
Right.
There's only one door for the sheep.
Right.
Might be a lot of doors for the goats,
right.
But there's only one door
That's
for
right.
the sheep.
Yeah.
And if we want to have fellowship with God, we only can access Him through Jesus, and we have to come through Jesus
right.
to Him.
Yeah.
There is no other way.
Amen.
Romans chapter 5, verse 1 and 2 gives us some very important information concerning that. And it tells what our relationship is when we obey
right.
and we meet the requirements. The requirements are to come through the door.
Right.
To have that one way.
Right.
The Holy Spirit says, this is the way, speaking
right.
of Christ, walk in this. And if we do that, Romans chapter 5, verse 1 says, Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God
Amen.
Through our Lord Jesus
right.
Christ.
Right.
Not through whoever, but
right.
through Him. He is
right.
our only hope, our only
yeah.
salvation is the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
And it says, By whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in the hope
Amen.
Of the glory of God. So we have access into grace through Jesus.
Right.
And without Jesus, there is no grace.
Right.
Without
right.
grace, there is no salvation.
Amen.
It
right.
becomes incredibly important for us to understand that the Lord Jesus is the basis of our salvation
right.
and the only access to the Father, just like the cloud over the mercy seat for
right.
them in the Old Testament was the only manifestation of God's presence there. Jesus is the manifestation of God. It's in Galatians 2:9. It says, He is the fullness of the Godhead bodily.
Right, right.
And so if we're in Him, we've met the requirements.
Yes.
The benefit is we're justified by faith and we have access to grace through Christ. You remember Peter told them, repent and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Right.
But look in Titus chapter 1, verse 2. Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect, and the acknowledging of the truth which is after godliness, and hope of eternal life, now notice this, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began.
That's right.
So Peter said, if you repent, you'll receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, which of course is eternal life. And it says here that God has promised this. Even before the world began,
right.
He made
right.
this promise.
Right.
He made this plan.
Amen.
And the benefit for us is if we access the Father through His Son, we meet the requirements, so to speak. The benefit is we have access by faith into grace.
Right.
We're justified by the faith of Jesus, and we
Amen.
Have eternal life because God has promised that.
Amen.
And God cannot lie.
That's right.
The Bible says here in this verse, and He made this promise to His sheep.
Amen.
He said, here's the door, speaking of His Son.
Yes, right.
This is the way.
That's right.
You enter in through this.
Yep.
And the benefit is eternal life.
Amen.
You have eternal salvation. We're accepted in Him.
Yes. Right.
Not outside of
That's
Him.
Right.
Not alongside of Him.
Right.
Some people are far too casual about the Lord.
Right.
And salvation and
You're
His
right.
Word. Well, we're accepted in the Father's eyes. We're accepted in Christ.
Yes, amen.
And God keeps His promises.
Yes,
and He's promised eternal life to everyone that is in His Son.
Amen.
And I'm sure most of you here tonight are. You're saved. God has saved you.
Amen.
The blood of Christ washed away your sin. 1 John 1:9. The blood of Jesus Christ is uncleanseth us from all sin.
Amen.
It's not part of sin. You know, He put part
right.
of it, and then you got to finish
right.
the job, scrub up a little bit more.
Exactly.
No, that's not it.
That's right.
The blood of Jesus cleanseth us from sure most of you here tonight are children of God, but if you're not, if you're here tonight and you're not, the promises of God are sure.
Yes,
the promises of God are certain.
Yes,
they will not be ever broken.
Amen.
And so if the Holy Ghost is calling you, you need fellowship with the Father. There's only one thing to do is repent.
Yes.
And you will receive that gift of God, which is eternal life.
Good.
And that's the only way to get it.
Amen.
That's not available. I know the Pope has been in the news and said, well, you know, we have to understand our Muslim brethren. And I'm thinking, well, he identified himself there because they're not my brothers.
That's right.
And he's talking about Jesus isn't the only way. He might be the best way. Some of the things he said in the news just really makes your head spin. But I know he's Pope and highly revered, but I think I'll take the word of God.
Amen.
And God said there's one way. And I hope everybody here tonight has received that gift of the Holy Ghost.
Sir,
if you haven't, and God is calling you, I urge you strongly, repent, believe in the Lord, just like Peter told him.
Right.
Repent, believe, and you receive that gift, and I hope everyone here tonight does so.
Yes.
If you haven't already,